So today we are going to discuss on information security management, and government. So there are policy, procedures, standards, and baseline and guidelines. So which are we need to follow the things. So when we are going to work in an organization, it doesn't matter whether you are going to be the security officer there or not. If you are working anywhere where data is involved, then you must be aware of all these things. Another thing, if you are a person who is maintaining the security, or you are going to work for the security of any company, then you must be very much aware of all these things, and you have to have the capability to build the policy, write down the policy, or articulate the policies, procedures for the company. What are the standard to be followed? Okay, and what is the baseline, for the employees, and standards you have to maintain, and some guidelines you can generate for the users in the enterprise. So if you look at this, so this is a survey of 2020 data breach investigation report. So you can see 70% of breaches was caused by outsiders. 86% of breaches were financially motivated. That means they have somehow made targeted to make some financial loss, or getting some extortion money from the victim. Then 43% of breaches were attack on web applications, more than double the result from the last year. So you can understand this year it is the figure is gone double, attacks on the web applications. And 27% of malware incident can be attributed to ransomware. So you can see this is how crucial moment we are living in. Because everybody, each and every citizen, you can say, is using the internet. Everybody putting their data, transmitting their personal data over the internet, and putting them on risk, right? So your work at this moment becomes more, crucial and more important than anything else. Who are the security professionals? So if you see the data growth chart, according to IDC, that is a analytics company, so they are targeting that by 2025, the data is going to increase, the production of data is going to be 175 jettabytes. So you can understand, right? So how big is the quantity and how to protect that data? That is a big issue. Okay, so all the companies, all the enterprises will hold this data, including the social media companies. Now, question is that how to maintain them, how to make, store them securely. Remaining things, analytics and all, whatever people can gain from that data, all these things comes later. First thing is that how you are going to assure security of that data, privacy, integrity, and so the data is not going to be used for any illegal activity. So how to assure them? So that is the first concern and people should have, the company should have right now. Now organizations are struggling to manage uncontrolled data growth. So all the organizations are trying to manage how this data growth can be controlled, because as you can see, this is exponential. Maintenance and giving security is a big issue, right? And huge resources is needed. Then segregation of business critical data from non-critical data is very challenge, a big challenge. So what are these things? Critical data are the data which are having financial value, or which needs security. And you will not like to make them public, or somebody steal them, or some attack should happen on this data. You should not want at any point of time. That company have huge amount of data, and there will be many data which does not may not need enough security, like you know, this kind of you can say product information. So product information is quite open data, right? So only security is needed, that is the physical security. People, the attacker should not delete the data from your server, right? But critical data comes is which you are having, you know, like customer data. So this data is very much important and needs security, as these are someone's personal data, right? So how to segregate them, that is a big issue right now. Then CISO, that means Chief Information Security Officer, then DPO, Data Protection Officer, CIO means Chief Information Officer. And what are the risks and compliance term pain points? So if you see, the first question comes is, what data is critical for the enterprise? First consideration. So you have to understand, whenever you are in any enterprise, you have to understand that what data are the critical data. Then where is it residing in the IT ecosystem? I mean, the critical data you have, you understood, okay, these are the critical data. Now, where are you storing them? Okay, so is that a secure, you know, secure area where you are storing them? Do you have backup of that if some, you know, crash happens or anything? Then who have access to it? That means if it is a critical data, you will not like to give access to everybody to that database. Then which regulation compliance I am violating? That means that should be a question, you know, from your side. That are you violating any regulation or compliance by keeping this data, you know, with whatever security you are providing to that? Is that enough to maintain or to be compliance with the guidelines? Is my company's data secure? So that is the next question. Whether the data what you have kept, is it secure? Then what is my current risk level? You have to analyze your current risk level. Okay. So if you look at this, what these are two big analytics company, what they are speaking on it. If you don't know what you have, where it is and why you have it, you can't expect to apply appropriate policies and control to protect it. That means, first thing is that if you are in a enterprise, then you have to understand what you have, then what data you have with your company, and where it is residing, and why do you have it? That means, why have you collected and kept it? You have to know it. Is it going to give you or add you some value in future or in current scenario? Then if you don't know all these answers, then you can't expect to apply appropriate policies and control to protect it. Now, focus, another Gartner, another big company on analytics, focus on controls and that broadly address that problem, such as implementing people-centric security and data classification. These controls are foundation upon the additional control that can be built. So you have to understand this, implementing people-centric security and data classification. So once, if you understand the first code, then you will automatically understand the second code, that you need to classify. First classification comes is critical data and non-critical data. Then again, the critical data can be, you know, can have different classification, you know, top secret data, you know, private data, personal data, too many things can be there. So that classification you need to understand. Now, here are the two, you know, new things regarding WhatsApp popping up nowadays in new channels. So first one, you may have heard about Arnab Goswami's case. The question is that 500-page document between, you know, Arnab Goswami and former chief executive of BRC. So, you know, of social media leaked, you know, allegedly leaked on the social media. So this 500 pages of communication data, how did this, you know, data leaked, and who decrypted it? You understand? That is 500 pages means that is a long time. From a long time they was communicating. Now this communication data how became public? That means it was not having enough security, and even if there was some encryption algorithm, some security, then it was breakable. Otherwise, if it is done by the say, government request or police request, then definitely that security algorithm is not end-to-end security algorithm. That security, WhatsApp knows, if it is a WhatsApp communication, WhatsApp knows how to break the algorithm and extract the data. Okay, so you can understand that even if you are thinking that some app is secure, actually they may not be that much secure what you are thinking or expecting. Okay, and after that there was another issue was popping up, that is WhatsApp was saying that they will just share their data with Facebook, and there was a huge protest, and people was speaking against that. Now finally WhatsApp came up with this. You can see on the right side, we are committed to your privacy. So what they're saying again, you see, quite humorous, that WhatsApp can't read or listen your personal conversation as they are end-to-end encrypted. Now my question is, if they are end-to-end encrypted, if you can't hear or listen, then who leaked these 500 pages? Understand? This is the contradiction you have to understand, being a security professional. Then WhatsApp can't see you shared locations, see your shared locations. So numbers of time we share our location over WhatsApp, or even we keep our location on your phone. It is saying that WhatsApp can't trace you. So I don't know about how true this one. Okay, but the first point what they are making, the contradiction is already on the screen. Then WhatsApp does not share your content with Facebook. So this is another promise they are making. What they was claiming that they will share the data with Facebook, but they are now saying no, we are not going to share it. So you need to understand each and everything. Where in last class somebody asked me, said what will happen if they share. So this is the development regarding that, and definitely these are comes under privacy policy. If you where from where these data are coming, I have forgotten to give the link. It is coming from whatsapp.something.com or so, whatever is there, slash privacy. So if you go to the website of WhatsApp and go visit the privacy section, you will find this data. Okay, now policy to procedure. So you have to understand what is policy and what is procedure. They are definitely not same. Policy means what you are given in writing, what you are saying in written document, that this will happen, that you will do that, you will not, you should not do that, all these do's and don'ts things. And procedure is finally how it is going to be implemented in real, what procedure you are following, what mechanism you are installing. Okay, so and in between that, in the stack, standards come, baseline comes, and guidelines comes. So first you comes up with a policy, then you compiles it with your policy with different standard. I will show you some standard available. It doesn't matter whether you are in the, again I'm telling you, in the IT industry, sorry, in the security domain or not, you have to understand the standard, because when you will be deal with data nowadays, people are more mad about data analytics and machine learning. So when you are using machine learning, data analytics or AI, you are handling basically data of third party. Now when you are handling those data and when you are analyzing, what you can analyze and what you can't analyze, what is ethical to analyze and what is not ethical to analyze, you have to understand, and that is given in the standard. Okay, so it doesn't matter at what level you are working, in the company, whether as a security person or as a analyst, data analyst, or as a software developer or coder, whatever it is, you have to understand the standard standards. Otherwise your software is not going to be sold. Nobody will purchase your service if you can't assure the standard. Then comes baseline. Baseline means the minimum standard you have to follow. Okay, Then guidelines. Guidelines you give for your employees that, and your users that you can do this or you can't do this. Okay. And finally, procedure to assure that standard baseline guideline, all these things are being followed. You just adopt some procedure. You configure your system such way. You develop some algorithm such way so that data should not be leaked. Data should that CIAM things will be assured. Okay, so that is what the procedure comes with. Then security and privacy topic areas. If you see this, at the top there is governance. The governance means it can be industry governance or any organization you are governing. Then it comes to information security management system. Okay. Then it comes to ISM supporting guidance. That is basically course to practice information security control, risk management, evaluation, and all these things. And on the other hand, this side, on the right side, you can see ISMS accreditation, classification, and auditing. So you are quite familiar with this term, classification and auditing. Accreditation means how to get the standard. That means if you want to get the certification from the ISO and other organization, then this comes. Okay. And here you see under this, sector specific security control. That means what are based on the sector. So if it is a cloud computing is involved, then you have to find out what are the security control you need. If it is a simple standalone system, standalone server, but connected with the internet, then what are the things you need? All these things come there. Then security services and control. Here you can see many things from our syllabus thing, are there and which are needed here. Okay, so security control and mechanism converting ICT readiness for business community, IT network third-party services, IDS, that means intrusion detection system, and all these things are there. Then comes identity management and privacy technologies. So you have basically, people's identity will be with you, like their personal data, their blood group, many things which can reveal identity of the customer or users. So how you can manage them, that comes here. Then cards and personal identification, how we are going to identify your employees or users. You can have physical, they can have physical characteristics, or you can give some circuit card, machine readable card, or whatever procedure you want to follow. Then it can be biometrics, then comes cryptographic and security mechanism, including encryption, digital signature. All these things are in our syllabus at the bottom, you can see. Okay, all these things are in our syllabus, and they are comes under security and comes under the information security management system and governance. Okay, so you have to understand this very well, this architecture. Okay, now privacy creation on items. So the items are definitely data. So how you can do it? First one, you ask people to have passwords. Then you can have patch management. You can this can be part of your policy that you have to do patch management. Then the employee hiring and termination practices. So now that means when you are hiring the employee, what policy and things you are going to be taken as undertaken by the employee that they will not violate. That is what I was telling you in the previous class also. When you get your what is called offer letter from any organization or enterprise, you will find many things are written there. They are asking as an undertaking that you promise that you will not do this, that. Okay, then comes termination practices. That means when somebody is terminating an employee, then it must be assured that that before that employee leaving the company, he is not having any access, he have not taking any copy of the data with him. Okay, then backup practices and storage requirements, that you understand that what backup practices are there. If you have very much critical data, you may think about offsite backup practice or a backup technique. even inside it can be multiple places or multiple building. Okay, so that can be there. Then security awareness training, either time to time, your organization is organizing training for the employees. So people are usually overlooks this, but this is very much dangerous actually. Okay, when you will be in your company, you must suggest them to have security awareness training at least once a year. This is very important. Then antivirus, use of antiviruses and system setup and configuration, like, you know, if whatever operating system you are using, you must configure them, and you have to give a guideline that you should close this port all the time. You can use this port for accessing internet. So all this kind of configuration can be there. Then security policy. So what are these things, policy? So it is the top tier of formalized security document. Okay. So your first assignment will be developing a security policy. So that means you have to just develop a document for an organization which will be followed as a security policy. Then these high-level documents offer general statement about the organization's asset and what level of protection they should have. Understand? It will define in the organization what data are there, what are the data assets are there, and for each kind of data, what level of protection, what kind of protection is recommended. Then, well-written policies should spell out who is responsible for security. It will also tell you that who is responsible for security of which kind of asset. Then, what need to be protected, then which data need to be protected, what is an acceptable level of risk, that means what risk you already know this risks are there, but you are accepting, that should be defined, that this kind of risk you are accepting. Okay, then strategic plan to outline what should be done but does not specifically dictate how to accomplish the stated goal. So there will be some strategic plan, okay, outline saying that what should be done, but it will not tell you that how to accomplish the goal. Okay, but goal will be given in the policy document. Okay, and then these decisions are left for standard, baseline, and procedure. So goal is given. So this is a sub point under this. Okay. So goal is given, but why these things are not given, how it will be achieved? Because that is again left for standard, baseline, and procedure. So using these things, you are going to accomplish the goal. Okay. Then security policies can be written to meet advisory, informative, and regulatory needs. Each has a unique role or function. Okay. So this is what is about security policy. Okay. Then advisory policy. It is a consequences of certain behavior and action. Okay, so this is some action or behavior have been noticed by some employee. What will be the consequences? Illegal copying is one of the examples. Okay, employees should never download or install any commercial software, shareware, or freeware onto any network device or disk unless they have written permission from the network administrator. Do you understand? Very, very important point for everybody. Okay, when you are in a company, you are using company's desktop or laptop, you should not download anything, any kind of app, okay, which can share the data over online. Okay, and if you are downloading anything, you must have a written permission from the network administrator. Be prepared to be held accountable for your action. Now, whatever you are doing, you must be accountable for that, okay, including the loss of network privileges, written reprimand for promotion or employment termination if the rules of appropriate use is violated. Okay, so you can understand. So it can be, violation of such rule can lead up to employment termination. Okay, so this is very important thing. So then informative policy. This type of policy is not designed to enforce maintain mind. So it is basically not an enforcement policy. It is developed for education. Okay, so this is for education purpose of the people. Its goal is to inform and enlighten the employees. The following is example of informative policy. The next you can see. In partnership with human resources, the employees ombudsman's job is to serve as an advocate for all the employees, providing mediation between employees and management. This job is to help investigate complaints and mediate fair settlement when a third party is requested. Okay, so this is what informative comes under informative policy. So these are the information. Say if a third party comes up with your employee is not assuring this or is not maintaining such guidelines or policy, then this so there will be some advocate who can handle that basically. So regulatory policy, these policies are used to make certain that the organization complies with local, state, federal laws. This is very important. Okay, when you are developing anything or you are working somewhere, you have to just every time assure all these things. An example regulatory policy might state, because of recent changes to taxes, state law, the company will now retain records of employee inventions and patients for 10 years. All email messages and any backup of such email associated with patient and will be stored for 1 year. So that company can just declare it. Like in some institutes you will find that exam copies are stored for 3 years after you pass out, and after 3 years any student can't claim that I want to see my copy or anything like that or anything related to result. Okay, so these regulations and the things are equally applicable for any organization, okay, who are handling with data and their privacy. Okay, so these comes under regulatory policy. Then standards are much more specific than policies. Standards are a practical document between, they lay out specific steps or process required to meet a certain requirement. Okay, as an example, a standard might say it mandatory requirement that all email communication be encrypted. So although it does not specify certain standards, so it is not saying that which encryption algorithm, how many bits of key should be there, it is not saying. What it is saying, it should be encrypted. It does not spell out it is to be done. Okay, so that is left for the procedure. So here you can see some standard and guidelines. Okay, so which you need to remember when you will be there in the IT company. So standard guidelines, if we say ISO, IEC 27001, and some others are there, NIST SP 800 53 52, and so on. Many standards are there, so I'm not going into them right now. Okay. Then the manufacturer association and authorities have these guidelines. Profinet security guideline, then Ethernet and IP network, you already know, securing Ethernet and IP network. Okay, then BSI you have heard about, many things, CRT also you may have heard about. Recently India also formed a CRT. Then law and regulation, you can see IT Security Act, detective determining critical infrastructure according to BSI Act, okay, and so on. So these are the some overview. So if you see, in the previous slide I had told you about this, right? ISO 27001. So if you see here, what is the benefit of having this standard? This is standard, right? So that reduces the chance of security breaches within your IT environment. Confidentiality of the information it assures. Okay. Then minimization of IT risk, possible damage, and consequential costs it minimizes. Okay. Then competitive edge due to recognized standard, increase in trust with respect to partners, customers, and the public. So when you say that I have ISO standard this, then people will start believing and trusting on the company, on the service provider. Okay. Then a structured method to address compliance and requirements, fulfillment of internationally recognized requirement, because most of the companies are MNCs, they're multinational companies, and they basically do business in different countries with the same software. Now how these softwares can be sold in different country, they don't follow a certain standard which are agree or which is accepted in all these countries where they are working. Okay. Then systematic detection of vulnerabilities, lower cost, and control of IT risk. Okay. Now here you can see the leveraging industry standard and framework. So this one, ISO 27001, 44.93% are using. Then NIST cybersecurity framework, almost 40% are using. Then we are currently not using any, almost 29% companies. Then payment card industry data security standard, PCIDSS, another standard, which is used by almost 27.5% of the people or industry. Then Center for Internet Security, Critical Security Control, CIS. It is also adopted by 27.54% of the industry. Okay, so this is the overall thing. You can understand that how it is important. Okay, and these people, they are not following. Basically, if your customer is totally unaware about the standard, then only these, I think, then only these people can do business. Okay. Then this is one of the benchmark security standard in the world, and it was came in 1996 United States, called as Health Insurance Portability and Accountability Act. So as health insurance industry in USA started using data in the soft form during that time, so it was needed to introduce a law for them. So safeguard one is administrative safeguards, which gives the security management process, assigned security responsibility, workforce security, information access management, security awareness training, then security incident procedures, contingency plan, evaluation, business asset, contracts. So, and then it gives physical safeguards like facility access control, workstation use, workstation security, device and media control. So who can do what and all these things. Then technical safeguards like access and audit control, transmission security, integrity, and person or entity authentication. So all these things are assured if some company or some organization is adopting HIPAA as their standard. Then another very much popular all over the world is GDPR, or General Data Protection Regulation, that is European Union 2016 by 679. Okay, if you see the checklist, what it says that is personal data processed in your company. So first thing, if yes, then you need a GDPR. Is GDPR applicable to your company? That you need to analyze. Then do you process special categories or personal data again If you are processing personal data, then you must have GDPR. Then what does the national resolution provide? You have to, you know, compare with that, you know. Then is the PD transmitted, personal data transmitted to third countries or international organization? If, say, you are doing here, business in India, you are collecting personal data, are you storing this data in some server which is in other country? Are you have some, you know, developers or workers or employee in some other country who are working on that data? If it is yes, then GDPR must be followed. Okay. Then what role does your company play in data processing? What kind of processing you do? That means, do all policies and other corporate documents relating to processing of personal data comply with the regulation? Okay. Then data protection impact assessment, when and how and what? Do you need data protection officer, DPO? Then are you are processors aware of personal data processing policies and responsibilities? Processor means they are the people who are processing. Okay, so you can understand these standards are very, very needed at whatever, you know, segment you are working. It doesn't matter whether you, I'm telling you repeatedly, it doesn't matter whether you are in security domain or not. Even if you are, you know, data, you are a data analytics engineer or something else working in ML or developer, anything, people should be aware of GDPR. Then this was the Indian IT Act 2000. So the Indian, no, the Indian IT Act 2000 need to be amended to deal with nonsense and nuisance of cybersecurity. The act need to be feature proof. So this slide is a quite old slide. So this that's the reason it is written like this. So some of the things, it address the privacy issues in the existing IT Act, because before 2000 also there was IT Act of India. So it was a modification, amendment up to that act. Okay. Then address privacy. Okay. Then empower CERT to enforce stricter and substantial potential on defaulters. Penalties on the defaulters. So if there is some defaulters, whatever the penalty, they can sanction. Okay. So all these things are there. Okay. So if it is in India, so Indian IT Act is going to be followed. That's the thing. Now baseline. Baseline is the minimum level of security of a system, network, or device must be adhered to. Okay. The minimum level of security what you must have. Okay. Then baselines are usually mapped to industry standard. So this must be, mapped with the industry standard. As an example, an organization might specify that all computer systems comply with a minimum trusted computer system evaluation criteria C2 standard. So this is TCSEC is a standard given that in which it is given that what is the minimum amount of security or configuration should be there in each computer of a organization. So that can be followed and it can be just stated in the policy. This is our baseline. Now guidelines, I have already told you, right? A guidelines point to statement in policy or procedure by which to determine a course of action. It's a recommendation or suggestion of how things should be done. It is meant to be flexible, so it can be customized for individual situation. Then procedure also, you came to know the procedures are the most specific of security document. A procedure is detailed in depth, step by step document that details exactly what to be done. That means, and like, what algorithm will be applied, what encryption algorithm, what key exchange algorithm will be applied, with how, you know, how many bits of key will be used, everything is in detail, it is given. Then, as an analysis, secret recipe of thriller cake, it describes step by step what need to be done and how. So if you look at a secret recipe, of three layer cake you want to prepare. So if you see in the recipe, you will find that everything is written in step by step way, what to be done and how it should be done. It even specifies a convection oven. So it simply does not say you need an oven. It specifies that what kind of oven you need, which stated was an absolute requirement. It also mentions that this is the absolute requirement. You should not ignore this. Okay, so this is what is procedure. So this is something spending your whole cybersecurity budget on fancy tech and having none left for staff awareness training is looks like this. So says one company purchased many things, antivirus, firewall, intrusion detection system, all good things, good software, operating system, hardware, everything. But if a company don't organizing awareness training for the employees, then the security of that organization will look like this. This is the representation. Okay, now what ethical hackers do? They find the vulnerability, then they penetrate, do testing for penetration, is it possible or not, then they gather the intelligence, how we will execute our plan, then they scan the network, then they gain access of some of the resources, then hide tracks, that means they just try to hide for some time into the network so that they can gain more privileges and they can infect more numbers of resources, then analyze and report. As they don't do it for money or things, so they analyze and report. Okay, so there is a thing what can be adopted as a part of security policy given by National Cyber Security Center. So I'm not just discussing this one, we don't have enough time. Okay, then again, here is a cyber security solution of India, 5 best practices for preventing cloud misconfiguration. What are the checklist they're giving? Check permission control of each of the employee, implement security measures such as logging and encryption, choose right security solution, then constantly audit for misconfiguration and compliance, and check for policy compliance before provisioning, before provisioning. Okay. Here the whole realm of bad effects of internet in compromised of internet is compromised of. First one is cyberbullying. This is from the personal perspective. So people are easily gets bullied on social media, and there is very dangerous statistics. People are also committing suicide due to the bullying, and some other actions are happening. Then the cyber stalking, sexting, then inappropriate content, social media addiction, all these things are there. So this is not it. Now, this is how the password, if you are using passwords as authentication policy, then this is how it is going to be cracked by the attacker. So why it is there? Because, password is a part of policy document. You will just suggest that password should be like this, that it should be should have minimum length of 8, it should contain at least one capital letter, one number, etc., all these things. Okay, so it can be cracked by because when you are preparing the policy, you must be aware of the risks or vulnerabilities to one password. First one is that interception, that somebody somehow intercepts your packet, then searching, then stealing the password, then somebody can do a brute force, then key logging, that means somebody can install a key logger on your system and just read every key you are typing on the system, on the keyboard. Okay, then social engineering is another thing, then manual guessing, then shoulder surfing. That means when you are entering, somebody from your back is watching what you are typing. So password is not enough. We go for multi-factor authentication. Okay, so sometimes it becomes password and fingerprint or some biometric things. Okay. So nowadays it is very important, very much popular in Gmail also. Always, you will find they are suggesting you use two-factor authentication, like your password and your and OTP from through your mobile phone or a pattern on your mobile phone. So if you want to log into your mail from any new system, you have to enter your password and you have to have your mobile phone to enter the pattern or OTP.